Just as we look back on the great Renaissance masters, the human figure, like Da Vinci, Michelangelo, and Raphael, so too will future art historians look back on the great masters of the human figure from our time, the great superhero artists like Kurt Swan, Carmine Infantino, and Jack Kirby, whose superheroes were was our Michelangelo. And just as Michelangelo had his pietà, did not Kirby have his pietà? Is this not Wally Wood's Samson? What about Steve Ditko's Spider-Man? Into print later this summer, and the cards that I gave you can see information about it. The show that I'm going to present to you today is actually a kind of a sequel to the lecture I did last year in San Diego on the field of illustration and comic art. Recently, Vanity Fair magazine conducted a survey trying to determine who the greatest living artists are, and the top vote-getters were Gerhard Richter, Jasper Johns, Bruce Nieman, Cindy Sherman, Ellsworth Kelly, and Richard Serra, who handed in this thing. But Rob Imes, who directs the Ditkomania Facebook group, wrote about this and he said, Steve Ditko, of course, was not on the list. No cartoonist would be considered a great artist in the same league as a fine artist whose work appears in museums. Or should he be? Realistically, is Steve Ditko one of America's greatest living artists? If yes, why? If not, why not? And what about Joe Kubert? All the great comic book artists learned from the syndicated comic strip artists of the early 20th century, like Hal Foster, who then went on from Tarzan to do Prince Valiant. Flash Gordon by Alex Raymond, the other great realistic comic strip artist. And the third, the Trinity, was Milton Caniff of Terry and the Pirates and later Steve Canyon. Then you've got the more cartoonier comic strip artists like Chester Gould, who had more of a gridded diagrammatic panel design. Crazy Cat, more cartoony even and fanciful. Of course, the father of them all was Winsor McCay's Little Nemo. In the early 20th century, as these comic strips were happening, a lot of the great comic strip artists like Cliff Sterrett, Apollo and his pals, would play around with the intersection of the fine art museum world and comic strip art. Look at Gasoline Alley by Frank King. This is a famous strip in which he has the characters actually go in to fine art paintings. But I'm going to talk more about the intersection of fine art with comic book art. Most people think of pop art when they think of comic book art in the fine art world. This is considered the very first pop art painting, but it's not even a painting. It's a collage by Richard Hamilton. He did this in 1956. He's English, not even American. And he put together this collage, and if you look at all the different pieces, First of all, the reason why it's called pop art is because of the Tootsie Pop right in the center. But in doing my research, I found this collage from 1947 by Eduardo Pelosi, who was a Scottish artist living in London. He did this image in 1947 and exhibited it in London in 1952. And you can notice the pop word right there. So maybe Richard Hamilton, living in London and being an artist, might have seen this as well. But our focus really is on the Richard Hamilton collage. And obviously, if you look in the background, what do we see but a young romance comic book cover by Jack Kirby and Joe Simon, his partner, from 1950. And that actual image was taken from a small house ad in the comic books. And you can see in its sister title, Young Love. Joe Simon and Jack Kirby, this is a shot from the early 1940s. They're working for DC Comics, doing Boy Commandos. But of course, they're known for their co-creation of Captain America. Later on in the 1950s, there's Simon and Kirby. They created the genre of romance comics overnight with this young romance. Later on in the 60s, Kirby leaves Simon and joins up with Stan Lee in the late 50s at what was called Atlas Comics, later became Marvel Comics with the debut of Fantastic Four, number one, considered the kickoff of the Marvel Universe. But the same year that this came out, an illustrator named Andy Warhol was doing window displays for Bonwit Teller, a very classy New York department store. And this debuted in April 61. If we look closely, what do we see but one of his very first pop art paintings? And this was a Superman panel taken from the great Superman artist Kurt Schaffenberger. This was published a year before, in 1960. Now you can see how important Warhol's early comics work was when you see retrospectives of his work using these early images. Warhol also painted things like the Batman logo, which was done again in 1961. The closest red and white Batman logo I could find was this issue from 1958. So maybe Warhol might have been using this, and that's the Batman artist. That's actually Kurt Swan, who drew Superman, but also did a lot of Batman covers. Warhol was a big Batman fan. Here's a famous shot from Esquire magazine in 1966 with Nico, the singer from the Velvet Underground. And again, you can see how important Warhol's early comic strip paintings were to his career when retrospective posters like this still feature those images. Warhol did other comic strip paintings like this one of Dick Tracy and this one of Popeye. Later on in the summer of 61, another New York artist named Roy Lichtenstein started doing paintings like this, not yet known with the big dots, but paintings of comic strips. And supposedly Warhol went to his studio and saw this painting and figured, you know, he's doing comic strips better than I. But there is talk that maybe Lichtenstein saw Warhol's Bonwit Teller windows months earlier, and that gave him the idea to do comic strip paintings. But Warhol, as you know, went on, left the comic strip paintings behind, and went on to do his famous silkscreen camel suit pants and things. But he never left his superhero comic book love behind. Later on in the 80s, he did this Superman painting, silkscreen, and that was featured in the retrospective by the Museum of Modern Art in 1989, 2 years after he passed away. When I picked up the book, I noticed inside there were these 8.5 by 11 collages that I had never seen of Warhol's work using actual comic book panels splattered with paint. If you can look closely, they're dated 1960, not even 1961. And then I see this one. There were like 8 of them. The problem is that I was reading Superman comics in the 60s. And you see that panel on the right? That's taken from a Superman comic from 1969. And yet they're dated 1960. So I contacted a comic book historian friend of mine, and his sister wrote for the San Francisco Chronicle and put together this article basically saying, how can collages dated 1960 be be used upon the panels. Long story short, this never really got too much traction. I tried to do this illustration talking about how the fact that maybe the second greatest painter from the 20th century after Picasso has fraudulent works in the Museum of Modern Art catalog raisonné, and yet nobody seemed to care because of the basic idea that even art historians at museums don't know about comics. And the only way whoever perpetuated this fraud could have gotten away with it was with the idea that nobody's going to notice. You know, Warhol was sued when he used a photograph of the irises for one of his silk screens. Well, the Museum of Modern Art obviously knows about photography. They don't know anything about comics. So this has been a driving force in my career to get comics appreciated by the straight media world so that fraudulent images, and by the way, if you know about Warhol, he had his mother sign his work. He had a million assistants. So whoever perpetuated the fraud, I'm not saying it was actually Warhol, did it with the knowledge that nobody would notice except guys like me and my friend Richard Chinax. But back to Lichtenstein in 1961, after he did these early comics strip paintings, he started to do the works from comic book panels that he's most known for. And here's a shot of him in his studio. What he would do would take actual comic book panels. This was from a DC romance comic illustrated by an artist named Tony Abruzzi. But unlike what most of his detractors would say, he did not just straight trace these or even copy them. If you look closely, he transformed them into new images and he changed the context of the comic book panels. Here's a war comic by the DC artist Irv Novick, and look at Lichtenstein's transformation of it. They are not just, you know, robotic copies or duplicates. Look at them above and below, and you can see this is not just a straight transformation. If there are any graphic designers out there, Lichtenstein was acting more as a graphic designer. But there's an entire website devoted to debunking Lichtenstein. It's called Deconstructing Roy Lichtenstein. In 1963, he does this painting called Mad Scientist, which was taken from a Mike Sikowski panel from the comic book Justice League of America that appeared in the year 1962, a year earlier. One of Lichtenstein's most famous paintings, Image Duplicator, from the same year, 1963, used the Jack Kirby Magneto panel. And there's Magneto from X-Men number 4, where he was featured. The same year, 1963, DC Comics had a comic book called Doom Patrol, which was created right around the same time as X-Men and also featured outcast superheroes. If we look at this issue and come in close on that panel was also used by Lichtenstein to make Image Duplicator. So with the growth of pop art in 1963-64, by 1965, for a couple of months, Marvel Comics was actually using this expression in the little cover panel box. And this wasn't the last time Magneto was featured in pop art. Years later, Paul McCartney and Wings, in their 1974 album, Venus and Mars, put out a single, Magneto and the Titanium Man. Now, that's not Jack Kirby's art, that's George Tuska, but Kirby designed the characters, and Tuska, like all the Marvel artists, adopted the Marvel style. But there is Paul McCartney on the left, Linda McCartney on the right. Backstage, they met their hero, Jack Kirby. And it's interesting about McCartney and Lennon, because if you look at the 1960s, what they did for rock and roll, Lennon and McCartney, so too did Lee and Kirby do for comics. And it's interesting about the parallel between Lee and Kirby and Lennon and McCartney is that in 1961, before the very first issue of Fantastic Four hit the newsstands, Martin Goodman, the publisher, did not like the original title Stan Lee chose, which was the Fabulous Four. He had him change it to the Fantastic Four. So think about it, Martin Goodman hadn't made that change, the Fantastic Four would have been the first Fab Four. And this is a double-page spread in my Silver Age book. But the Beatles themselves were comic book fans. And it looks like they were DC Comics fans. Because look at the lineup of comics on top of the keyboard there. It's all DC Comics. And I bet you one of them that they read was probably this issue from 1961, illustrated by Kurt Swan. And if we come in close on the Superman figure, what did we see but the third great American pop artist, Mel Ramos, who was doing images like this in 1962, a year after that comic book. There's his Batman. You could see that his style was more the thick buildup of paint. But Mel Ramos is famous, and he did pop art paintings like this, of advertising images, products. If we look at this exhibit and turn the corner, what do we see but a painting called The Trickster? And you can see Ramos' style. This painting was recently auctioned off by Bonhams New York for $100,000. Now, if you look closely at this painting and the sketch that he took it from, let me read you the description in the Bonwood catalog. It says, "The Trickster is a classic Ramos work, awash in the California-inspired color palette, imparted to Ramos by his mentor Wayne Thiebaud, and featuring a distinct impasto technique throughout." But then they go on to describe it, and what's interesting is when you look at the sketch that he did, the following can actually be said of Ramos' source material. "The Trickster features the 1960 DC Comics supervillain, the Trickster, arch nemesis of the Flash, gleefully escaping an unknown pursuer, his expertly rendered hands clutching stolen jewelry. The movement of the figure is particularly striking, especially the treatment of the Trickster's shoes, which were capable of walking on air. As a result, the figure floats effortlessly above the ground." Well, that's a description applied to the source material, which was Carmine Infantino, the great artist of the Flash. So I consider Ramos's work the least transformative of the other two artists, Lichtenstein and Warhol, because it was pretty much a straight copy. So all the criticism that's applied to Lichtenstein should really be applied to Ramos instead. But there's a double page spread introduction of Carmine Infantino in my book. There is the image he did of all the characters he's most famous for, but of course, the one that he is most famous for is the Flash. And the Flash is all about movement. That's what the Flash was all about, Infantino said. That's what made the character. He was tough to do because of the constant speed. Every page ought to have constant motion. Even when it was quiet, you'd need motion. And it had to be done differently each time. Sometimes I had a single figure with these lines, other times multiple figures, because it would get boring with just one sort of motion. And the Flash was not built like a superhero if you look at him carefully. He's not built like Batman, he's a runner. And runners don't have those kinds of muscles. They're very lean. Of course, I watched a lot of animation. That helped too, that's part of the Flash. Speaking of animation, this is Marcel Duchamp's New Descending a Staircase from 1912. And Duchamp said that in 1912, the idea of describing the movement of a nude coming downstairs while still remaining static visual means to do this particularly interested me. And of course, the motion picture with its cinematic techniques was developing then too. The whole idea of movement, of speed, was in the air. My aim was a static representation of movement, a static composition of indications of various positions taken by a form in movement. And in my opinion, that can be applied directly to the graphic innovations of speed that Infantino did with the Flash. Images like this that are icons of speed that graphic designers and a whole generation of artists have now adopted. Now, when I look at an image like this, I think of The Great Wave by Katsushika Hokusai that you've all seen in prints and in museums. And I find Infantino's Flash just as beautiful as that image. I don't make any value discrepancy between the two. What I love about Infantino also were his kind of California suburban modern motifs. This was a small panel in a Flash comic. And there's an image from an architectural magazine from that era. And you can see how Infantino took off of that. I loved Infantino's interior designs, which were taken from the advertisements and the designs of the day. This panel happened to be a panel not from The Flash, but from his other great feature of the early 60s, Adam Strange, Earth's first spaceman. What Infantino had to say about Adam Strange was, the interesting dichotomy was, first you see him on Earth, and then you see him on Ron, two different worlds. And that's important. If you can't get that difference, you lose it. Infantino went on to say when I interviewed him, what you're looking at here is pure design, putting all the weight on the figure and keeping the background linear. That's the way you get dimension. That's the way I always worked. Now, Peter Saldon, an American art critic, wrote, the rakish stylization and the succulent color were easy to enjoy, and the payoff was sanguinely erotic in a way that endorsed my personal wishes to be bold and tender and noble. Oh, but he wasn't writing about this image. He was writing about one of Infantino's major influences, Modigliani. Infantino said that Modigliani and Degas influenced me the most. They have a feeling of motion in their stuff, like Degas' ballet dancer. By the way, Infantino did a very elongated, thin figure like Modigliani, the elongated man. If we come in close on him, you could see the relationship exaggerated in comics to his elongated figures of Modigliani. And he said that Degas' ballet dancers, there's motion there, but they're standing still. This is the Degas called Miss Lala at the Cirque Fernando. Art historian Charles Stuckey said, it's Degas' fascination with the depiction of movement, including the movement of a spectator's eyes as during a random glance. Degas himself said, in art, nothing should look like chance, not even movement. Look at Infantino's Adam Strange figures, almost feminine in a way. Infantino said Adam Strange had a different sort of movement than the flesh. He moved, he was fast, he had speed, but he was subtle. Not like the flesh, it was obvious. Adam Strange was not that obvious. Look at this panel, one of my favorite of Infantino's. And when I showed this to him, he said that this panel was influenced by a Chinese painter named Chen Qi. He's the most beautiful watercolor artist. I studied him like mad. He would do one small figure and the rest of the painting would be nothing but a brick wall. I love Infantino's depictions of nature in Adam Strange. This is just a little 3-inch panel. But what I love about it is, unlike Lichtenstein, you don't have to repaint the comic book panels to be thought of as art. If you just blow them up like I'm doing here, and by the way, I would be happy until I get an IMAX screen behind me with these images and like an audience like Martin Luther King's 63 speech. But in addition to being a master of the natural world, look at Infantino's futuristic landscapes, which were incredible. Let's hope one day they make a film that actually brings his visions of futuristic landscapes to life. At the same time Infantino's doing this, another artist over at Marvel Comics was doing images like this of the city, grim, foreboding. This, of course, is the work of the great Steve Ditko. That's the last panel of the very first Spider-Man comic, The Origin. And that panel is the size of a postage stamp. When you blow it up like this, to me, it looks like a German expressionist work. Here's an image from the cabin of Dr. Caligari, made in 1927. And that's what I think of when I look at that great Ditko city, which was actually New York. It wasn't a made-up city like the DC Comics characters. Of course, Ditko's known for Spider-Man, and it's that costume design, maybe the greatest, most unique costume in the history of comics, that only Ditko did. And that's why the movies were so successful, because they were an exact translation of his incredible design. And that's why Spider-Man has become the icon that he's become. That's why the logo that Ditko did has become the logo itself of Marvel Comics, as the Mickey Mouse Disney ears are to Mickey Mouse. Yeah, meditate on that image for a while. It's like an acid trip without the acid. You know what I'm saying? But his other great character in Marvel Comics was Doctor Strange, that he created solo without Stan Lee. In 1963, Dr. Strange was known for having mind melds with his mentor, the Ancient One. Now, if you were reading Marvel Comics in 1963, you were getting images like this of a doctor and his mentor. But if you were watching American television the same year, you were being shown images like this of Ben Casey and Dr. Gillespie, his mentor. That's why comics were always years ahead of the rest of the culture. And in fact, when you look at the worlds of Dr. Strange that Ditko created, they were a direct influence on the psychedelic school of California poster artists that appeared 4 and 5 years later on the West Coast. To a man, many of these artists, that's one of the first Doors posters. Here's a Ditko Dr. Strange world. All of the psychedelic artists all said that they were influenced by Ditko's Dr. Strange worlds. I love this image, and look how this image from one of the very first LSD festivals, when LSD was still legal in San Francisco. In fact, Ken Kesey, one of his first acid test posters, if you look closely at the center of this poster, what do we see? But of course, Jack Kirby's Thor. If you read Tom Wolfe's Electric Kool-Aid Acid Test, the greatest book about the 60s and the psychedelic era, he talks about how in 1964, while Kesey and the Merry Pranksters were going across America, dosing people with then-legal LSD and kicking off what we know as the 60s, he said that the bus, Further, it was called, was festooned with Marvel Comics images, and that Ken Kesey was in the back of the bus, engulfed in the plunging purple shadows of Doctor Strange. But there's Thor by Kirby. He took Thor off the earth and brought him into these majestic, otherworldly landscapes. There's Odin. Nobody was doing like this in comics. Nobody's ever done it since. And that's where this image, of course, comes from April 1966. When I looked at this, I always said, why isn't that Kirby's PA tie? I mean, it is. But if aliens came to this world and they were not laid down by the baggage of 500 years of art history, and you show them this image, and you show them Kirby's Pieta, I don't think they would have the same value judgment that presently art historians presently do have, and would consider it almost blasphemous to dare compare that Pieta with the famous Pieta. But that's what Kirby did with his images. He would take biblical figures like Samson and update them for the modern era. In fact, Kirby went on to say in an interview, the truth is that the Greeks had Hercules, even as the Norsemen had Thor. And through the ages, we've had heroes similar to them. In ages past, we had Samson, who's no more than a superhero. And today, we have our superheroes. We believe in them because we believe in ourselves. Kirby went on after these Thor images to create even more godlike characters. And Kirby said about his costumes at this point in time, 1966, all my costumes have become more or less complex. I felt they had to. I felt the scenery had to become more complex. I felt a simple costume in the technological era that we have today would look out of place, so I made them as complex as possible. His figures and his machines were almost one and the same. Kirby said, I've always been inspired by conceptions of the future, and I incorporated it in my drawing. What I did was create machines that didn't exist, but they somehow looked practical enough to do the job that I wanted them to do in the story. I tried to give technology the touch of legend. And in fact, it was Kirby's technological landscapes that are our major motif of his work. They predate our computer circuits imagery of today. When you look at a Kirby image like this, in pure black and white, and the way it's compartmentalized, I think of the sculptures of Louise Nevelson, who did these box images, sculptures like this. And I feel Kirby's work is just as similar. But how did an uneducated son of American Jewish immigrants who grew up in the Lower East Side come up with these futuristic cityscapes after growing up in the cacophony of the Lower East Side? There's an art teacher named Andre Molichu who compares Kirby's cityscapes to everybody from Picasso's early Cubist work. And if you take the same cityscape, he said that they reminded him of Piranesi's cityscapes like this. He compared this Kirby hunk of machinery to the aggressive work of the abstract expressionist Franz Klein. Look at this Franz Klein image that he compared to a famous Jack Kirby panel from Fantastic Four. In these images of destruction, of awesome detail, you can see the cacophony and the destruction of the crumbling tenements of the Lower East Side that he came out of, that he somehow later incorporated into these images, that if you then see them in color, he was not only an artist of destruction on a massive scale, but an artist of creation. And Kirby said, "I used to read the first science fiction books, and I began to learn about the universe myself and take it seriously. I know the names of the stars. I know how near or far the heavenly bodies are from our own planet. I know our own place in the universe. I can feel the vastness of it inside myself." Space was a big influence on one of the next major Kirby motifs. This is an image that he found out of National Geographic in 1965, one of the very first images of a quasar from outer space. Kirby saw in those images what he would later create later on that year in the debut of Galactus, what's become affectionately known as Kirby Crackle, Crackle spelled with a K. Less than a year later, you can see the beginnings of the Kirby Crackle, but later on, in 1966, he creates this image, which is really the debut of the Kirby Crackle in Dr. Doom, the FF's major villain. I consider this image that it comes from, this full page, maybe the greatest single image of victory and defeat in one image, in not only the history of comics, but I would maintain in the history of art. Of course, his most godlike character was Galactus. That's the beginning of the motifs that Kirby would later work into his work. After doing stuff for Marvel and DC Comics, he started to do these portfolios of what he called the gods. And in portfolio images like this, he did his version, very abstract, of what he called God. It's a little hard to see. That's his giant knee in the foreground. There's his face in the upper left. Here's another image. You can see God's face in the left, and his idea of Earth was a world that was full of war and famine and hunger and disease and evil, forcing God to actually turn his back on the world, which was, if Kirby is our Michelangelo, in direct contrast to Michelangelo's most famous painting of God and man. But Kirby himself was the god of superhero creation, because from his hand came all the great Marvel Comics characters that are now making billions of dollars for Hollywood. But Kirby's most favorite character of all the ones he created, he claimed, was Captain America. And it was this Captain America image that made it to become the poster of the Museum of Contemporary Art in Los Angeles back in 06. That image was taken from this piece of original art inked by Sid Shores that is used on this Captain America cover. And of course, Captain America was his fighting figure from World War II that he brought into the 60s after Kennedy was assassinated in 63. Kirby felt we need to bring Captain America back. Later on, when he returned to Marvel in 1976, he did this Treasury edition, Captain America's Bicentennial Battles. And here is a double-page spread, top-tier panel that looks like it pays homage to the Gettysburg Cyclotron, which is an exhibit in Gettysburg, and that wraparound painting is 10 feet tall by 22 feet in circumference. And it has something similar with this Captain America image. But when we look at this image, in black and white pencil form. An artist friend of mine, Adriano Race, told me a year ago that it reminded him of Picasso's Guernica. And I think he's right on the money. Here's what was said. A writhing mass of clashing phantoms swarm across a battlefield, yet unseen. It's an astounding tableau because it leaves little doubt that these are the shadows of real men engaged in the deadliest game of all. Oh, except that description was not written about Guernica. That was written by Kirby for this particular panel. And listen to this description. Captain America is to comic books what Beethoven's Ninth Symphony is to music. A cultural icon that speaks to mankind not only against war, but also of hope and peace. Oh, sorry, that was said about Guernica. Picasso said while he was working on Guernica that my whole life as an artist has been nothing more than a continuous struggle against reaction and the death of art. This is a panel by Jack Kirby in 1975 for his World War II comic, The Losers. And when you look at it in color, it always reminded me of the famous Goya painting, The Third of May. And the art historian Kenneth Clark said, the Third of May is the first great picture which should be called revolutionary in every sense of the word, in style, in subject, and in intention. And this was said. This is a war which has jumped all previous boundaries. Civilians are killed, not by accident, but by design. They look wrong, they think wrong, they talk in ways intolerable to those with the gun. And when the gun begins to bark and cannot see men, women, and children, its sights are centered on labels, thousands of dying labels. But again, that was not said about 3rd of May. That was Kirby's passion to this image. And that was the work of the great Jack Kirby. But of all of his characters, he said, the way that the thing talks and acts, you'll find that's really Jack Kirby. He's got my manner of speech. He thinks the way I do. He's excitable. He's very active among people. And he can muscle his way through a crowd. I'm that sort of person. And that's why I use the thing in my double page spread introduction image to Kirby in my book. Kirby's mentor in the 40s was a young Jewish artist named Eli Katz, changed his name to Gil Kane. And when he went to work for DC Comics on his flagship character, Green Lantern, Kane said, I worked very hard to make my figures more fluid. Kane said, his decade-long drawing of Green Lantern, I worked obsessively to make my work better. All I've ever done in my mind is attempt to understand the figures so I can present them the most graceful way possible. Look at this double-page spread. He was influenced by Kirby in the upper left corner when he was working on Green Lantern in the middle panel. And then, when he went to Marvel and worked on Captain America, he adopted some of those images, some of that style, into his own work. When he worked on his other flagship DC character, the Atom, he said he was all about the trampoline, ballet, and jumping, and he tried to get this into his figures. The Atom, in reality, was Ray Palmer, and I used him as the first title page in my book. A couple of years after he left DC in 1971, he goes on to create what might be the first graphic novel, Black Mark. And he said that Black Mark is an important first. It contains all the elements of painting and film, drama and novels. The comic strip has always generated tremendous vitality and quality, but only recently has it begun to communicate ideas and make comment. To me, it's like exploring an undiscovered country. And he went on to say, I want to affect the reader in the same way that I've been affected by art in the past. Now that's a later Kirby drawing of Black Mark. And there is a painting of St. George and the Dragon by Raphael. Now Raphael did another painting of St. George and the Dragon a couple years later. But when you look at his sketch, which in Italian was called Cartoon, C-A-R-T-U-N-E, it's very much like all the sketches that the Renaissance artists did. This is Michelangelo's sketches, and look at Gil Kane's anatomy. And you could see the similarities in what the Renaissance masters, the human figure, were trying to do. Trying to speak about a perfection in man, like in Michelangelo's David, that I see in the work of the great Neil Adams, in what I consider to be maybe the single greatest Superman drawing ever. There's a self-portrait of Neil Adams, and his superhero figures were more dynamic and from angles like this that had ever been seen before. Look at this sketch that Adams did for a calendar image for DC Comics in 1976. And you can see it here. He was influenced by the great Norman Rockwell from this 1934 ad in the Saturday Evening Post. And it's Adams' lineup of figures in double page spreads like this that influenced the great comic book painter Alex Ross. So when he did images like this, you could see the Rockwell influence. Rockwell's famous paintings echoed by Alex Ross. Look at this image by Rockwell that he did in 1962 trying to take off of Jackson Pollock's drip paintings. Rockwell actually imitated Pollock, did a drip painting himself first, then put the man in front of it. He actually entered his Rockwell, his knockoff of Pollock into an art exhibit under a pseudonym and won the exhibit. But look at Mobius's piece of work done in the late 70s. Here's a photo of Mobius in an art museum and trying to talk about art and comic art like I'm trying to talk about it today. Look at this piece of art I found on the internet that takes off on that famous Rockwell image. That was taken from this Neil Adams double page spread in 1972. Whenever museums have ever done comics, they've always done comic appropriation. Here's a Museum Modern Art show about 5 years ago. They would do things like this, three-dimensional word balloons hanging in a gallery. Modern artists would take off of comics like this one by Sidmore Polke in 1976 called Supermarkets. Look at Jeff Koons' Elvis. Look at this Elvis done by Ron English. Even Mad Magazine gets in the act and knocks off the idea of fine artists doing comics. That lower left panel by Salvador Dali. Well, the great Jim Steranko would take images like that and work them into comic book art. He would take the op art movement from 1965, images like this, whose doyen was the English op artist Bridget Riley. And you can see that effect in Steranko's most famous cover of Shield One. Not only was he paying homage to Will Eisner's work from 20 years earlier, but Steranko doing this in 1968 was doing this at the exact same time that Peter Max was doing his psychedelic work. At the same time Neil Adams was doing his psychedelic work. In the same year, and he was influenced by Steranko's panel designs. But look at what Neil Adams did on this page. Individual panels that come together to form one large face of the character Deadman. It was faces like this that made Neil Adams say, you not only saw these characters as superheroes, you saw them as human beings. And when I used this image in the double page spread intro, Adams said, if superheroes really existed, they would look like characters that I draw them like. Here's an image from the Green Lantern Green Arrow series that I used in an invitation that I did in 1992 for one of my first lectures on comic book art in the 1960s that later became my Silver Age book. If you go to the second title page, you can see how I used that Neil Adams work from this landmark Green Lantern Green Arrow issue. When I got print magazine to commit to a special issue on comics in 1988, my opening double page spread was that Neil Adams Superman and trying to show how superhero art developed over the years. And that's the image that I brought together to create this verbal visual essay for this upcoming hardcover A1 that'll come out later this fall. That's edited by Dave Elliott. So you can see the double page spreads before I lay in the typography of all the images you've seen today. There's the Infantino spread and the type that goes with it, the Kirby spread, and the way I worked in the typography there. These are all double page spreads. There's the Buell Kane, Norman Rockwell, Neil Adams, and the type. And the 11th page ends with the psychedelic imagery. And on the cards that I gave you, you can find a Facebook site to go to, so you'll be able to get this hardcover book when it comes out. My book comes out later this fall, later this summer. That is the wraparound case wrap underneath the dust jacket. I'll be doing a series of seminars on the web about each one of these great artists. There will also be a digital version of the book. The ad that I wanted to do was nixed by Marvel Comics. Somebody called me the Silver Age Sensei, so I turned myself into Doctor Strange. But this is more my logo currently that I'm using, which of course, I'm more of a DC guy than Marvel guy, and I based it on the DC Comics logo. So I'm sorry if I ran a little over, but I think we have time for 5 or 10 minutes of questions. Oh, and there's Dave Elliott, the editor of A1 Magazine and A1 Book. And without Dave, I wouldn't have been able to do this. So I really want to thank him for giving me this opportunity to present art and comic art. So I think we've got about 10 minutes left, so I can take any questions and comments. And I want to thank you all for coming today. I really appreciate it. Yes, okay, we've got 5 minutes, so let's take some questions. Yes?
A long time ago, I started out as a fine artist, and I lost interest in it because it was very much deliberately separating itself from popularity.
Yeah.
It seemed like the more abstract and inaccessible you were, the more people would take you seriously in the commercial fine art world. And I was wondering, to me, at this point, they've completely disassociated themselves. You can't ask anybody, name a current painter, name a current calligrapher, or anything like that. And that's the way they like it. And so I was wondering what you thought about that.
The fact that what we can think
of. That current fine art, as opposed to 200 years ago, fine artists were popular, people knew
who
they were.
If you saw the Vanity Fair, I mean, how many of you recognize, you know, some of those artists? But they are the famous fine artists. So they're still busy trying to show how fine artists are using comics. But until they get me to curate a show at the Museum of Modern Art, you're not going to see comics in a museum done right. Thank you. Yes, back there. Okay, I'm a little hard to hear, so somebody just kind of net out what you just asked me.
Non-superhero comics.
What about him?
DC art.
Listen, J.H. Williams III, I consider the state-of-the-art comic artist. The guy knows how to draw. His pages are like, every page is like a Steranko Phantasmagorical spread. The art in comics is brilliant. I happen to see myself as the curator of the great Silver Age artists. I mean, they're all pretty much dead now. Steve Ditko's alive, but he's the Greta Garbo, J.D. Salinger of comics, so he ain't talking. You got Neil Adams, you got Jim Steranko, formerly the Young Turks, and they're in their 70s. So I'm looking upon myself in books and lectures to keep what I consider to be our Renaissance masters. Maybe one day there'll be a Kennedy Center Honors for Jack Kirby and Infantino and Neil Adams and Steranko, the great American artists that have inspired all of us, that created this whole convention. And I think we have to stop. Okay, left top. I want to, again, thank everybody. Please Facebook friend me. Come join my groups. All the information.
Stay here for a young